There are 30 or so different species of birds that spend most of their days along Texas beaches and bays. From the greater yellowlegs and American avocet to the piping plover, these are all shorebirds. But with both development and beachgoers on the rise, the birds face serious challenges. From a loss of nesting habitat to the daily struggle for space on the beach. But these birds have allies.
And the sanderlings are really aggressive.
There are sentinels of the shoreline all along the coast.
The birds have picked through a lot of this.
These are all folks you'll meet.
See, looks like we've got a banded plover down here by the water's edge.
Who are working to protect these Texas treasures, collectively known as shorebirds.
It's somewhat repetitive, but here we go. So, sanderling, sanderling, laughing gull. Ruddy turnstone, a little bit there, sanderling.
For three decades, Tony Amos has counted the number of shorebirds along a 7-mile stretch of beach on Mustang Island.
Sanderling, 2468-40, 2468-50, 2468-60.
You've heard of addictions,
4, 5, 6,
right?
6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12.
I'm addicted to counting things.
Using an old Hewlett-Packard computer from the 1980s, he's counting birds and people.
So we have people too, dogs too.
Tony's study looks at the boom in beachgoers and their impact on the birds.
They are constantly disturbed just by strolling on the beach, and it's a day-to-day thing that the birds have to endure.
Many of these birds have migrated thousands of miles from their nesting grounds in the Arctic, and once they're here, they need to rest or loaf.
They're not feeding, they're just there. They're often in communities of mixed groups of birds, and they need to loaf just the same way that we need to relax every now and again. See, I hate that.
Unleashed dogs are another big stressor for the birds and for Tony.
These are migratory species, they're actually protected. And the dog is chasing them and disturbing them in a very aggressive way. And some of these birds, at certain times of the year, have just crossed a whole ocean and they're absolutely exhausted. Hello. You know, your dog should be on a leash. He's chasing the birds, and these birds are migrants that have come in for... Well, I know I'm not unsympathetic to what he needs, but it's also the law.
As Tony's research wraps up his 30th year, he continues to keep a close eye on the threatened piping plover.
I need to see if they got bands.
Which spends over half of the year here on the Texas coast.
He goes along and he moves his foot on the wet sand, and then he pecks over here. And he moves this foot and he pecks over here, and I've never quite decided why he does that. Maybe it can detect these animals underneath its foot, but it's quite remarkable. So they're just amazing birds. They're well worth preserving. And if we don't preserve it, it's another fascinating thing and part of nature that we will lose.
Like the piping plover, all shorebirds have voracious appetites as they store up fat reserves for their yearly migration. And many of the tiny invertebrates the birds feed on live in a seaweed called sargassum.
Sargassum is a brown algae. It's got everything that they can use.
John Adams and other biologists want to change the mentality of what a beach should look like. While this is a typical postcard shot, this is what the birds need.
There's a nudibranch right there. That's a mollusk that doesn't have a shell. There's a shrimp right there. Can you see him? It's just a whole ecosystem right here.
The idea is to leave the seaweed as opposed to scraping it off with a front loader. And that's just the case at Padre Island National Seashore, south of Corpus Christi.
Padre Island National Seashore protects one of the longest stretches of undeveloped barrier islands in the world. We have sanderlings, we have long-billed curlews, we have the piping plovers, we have Wilson's plovers. Ruddy turnstone is another species. Can you see that running around in the sargassum quite a bit? But the sargassum plays an important role for these birds that call this place home.
Further down the coast at South Padre Island, a beach city that survives on tourism, they too have changed their attitude about seaweed.
We are taking efforts to work more with Mother Nature.
They use the sargassum to prevent erosion.
This is a good example here of one of the areas that we are trying to restore the dunes by using sargassum deposits that have been washing up on shore.
And at South Padre, gone are the practices of beach clearing every day.
I think that our tourists are going to appreciate that fact once they're educated and know why we're doing this, why we're not grooming those beaches every day.
Here and elsewhere, coastal cities are changing the image of what a typical Texas beach should look like.
It's a sales package, a change in perception. The tourists don't ask that they scrape up all the pine needles in the national forest, or they don't ask them to mow all the grass in the meadow at Yellowstone. Why would they ask to remove the sargassum from the beach?
Ike slammed into the Texas coast early this morning, and now the search, rescue, and recovery begins.
Oh, God, look at that.
In 2008, Texas beaches were hammered by Hurricane Ike, destroying homes and habitat, not only displacing people, but shorebirds as well.
What we've been able to find is that a number of the birds that were located along the upper Texas coast, where it was severely impacted, have in fact moved further down the coast south.
Funded by Texas Parks and Wildlife, Ben Wardwell is searching the beaches of the upper coast on the lookout for plovers.
Here we go. I think I was over here down by the water. This is another one of our common winter residents here. This is a black-bellied plover. This project I'm working on right now is studying a group of birds called the sand plovers, which include the Wilson's plover, the snowy plover, and the piping plover is the main focus of our survey.
Ben discovered that the hurricane actually had some positive effects as it created new habitat.
One thing I'm seeing after the hurricane is a lot of new tidal cuts have opened where backwater areas that have initially were isolated now have cuts that reach all the way to the Gulf, providing an intermingling zone of fresh and salt water, which is highly productive for shorebirds. Any and all efforts we make, particularly here on their wintering grounds, are going to have a positive and prolonged effect on their ability to reestablish themselves as a species.
Tony's study on Mustang Island and Ben's survey of plovers have one common thread. No matter the species, shorebirds here in Texas need their space.
One of the things that we can do here on the coast to turn it around is really be aware of what their habitat needs are and just be respectful of them.
There is a way, perhaps, of being aware. I think many people are really oblivious to birds. They're such a part of the background noise, if you like, that people don't really notice them. So I'd like people to be a little bit more aware. Maybe step around them a little bit, take a look for a while.